We're looking for the domain and range of this function. Remember, the domain is just a list of numbers. Okay, in any way that we can make that list, whether it be just a list of numbers. There's four numbers and I'm going to list them off. Or the list of numbers is actually infinite and you have to say things like all of the real numbers are possible or all of the positive numbers could go into this function. Okay? It's a list of numbers. It's a list of which numbers. The domain is a list of which numbers. The inputs. Okay, all the inputs that were used or all the inputs that are possible. So as we look at these points, each point gives us one input and one output. Okay? Gives us the input here of -2 and the output of 3. All right, so already I have 1/4 of my domain and 1/4 of my range, right? Okay. Domain, right? One of the numbers in the domain is what?
-2,
that's one of the inputs. One of the numbers in the range is what?
3.
Okay, look at this point. This point gives me, what does it give me about the domain? 0 is the next number in the domain. And it tells me that the another number that's in the range is what?
2.
All right, keep going. What's the next number in the domain that we see?
1.
Yeah, we get it. Remember, the input, right, is x, the output is y, the input here is 2. What's the last number in the domain?
1.
In the domain.
Oh, 4.
Trying to keep you on your toes here. Last two numbers in the range?
1.
1, 0. All right, does that make sense? Kids?
Are you supposed to put them, like, from least to greatest?
Typically, yeah, but it does not matter. It doesn't matter if the inputs line up with the outputs. It doesn't matter if they're in least to greatest order. That's typically how you will see it, least to greatest. Okay. Again, it's just a list. There's not really any correlation between the numbers that you see in the domain and the range directly. And the list might be in order, it might not be in order. Yeah?
And if you have more than one number, just have one.
Yep. If there's a number that appears twice in the domain, we got a real problem here. What is that called?
It's not a function.
Right, it's not a function. Very good, Grady. So if there's a number that appears twice in the domain, we have a thing that's not a function. If it appears twice in the range, that's fine. And since it's just a list of numbers, if that number appears twice, I don't really need to list it twice. Okay? Good. That's a good question. Don't have to list the same number twice. If you do see the same number in the domain twice, you don't have a function. That was 4. And my classics. 8 again. 6. Okay, so I'm going to try and do this so fast. Let's just kind of approximate. Okay, I'm sure we can all read what these points are. This one's at 2, negative 3. This one's at 3, negative 1. Where's the next one? Maybe somebody has their book open. Maybe somebody does. Okay. Well, if you do, then you can help me out. But 4, 1, and 5, 3. Okay. So again, it's just listing the domain and listing the range to make this a little faster. What's this? Yeah?
Domain.
I just circled all of the inputs. All of the inputs together are called the domain. So I can just put a little D there. And of course, if I circle all of the Y values or the outputs, then what do I have there?
Range.
Simple enough. And no repeats there, right? If we saw a repeat in a number in the domain, we'd see one point above another point, right? Because that would be two points that have the same input. If we saw a repeat in the range, that'd be two points that are what?
Next to each other.
Yeah, like across from each other horizontally. Okay? Can two points be across from each other horizontally and still have a function?
Yes.
Yes, right? That's just the same range, or the same output, that's okay. Can they be vertical of each other?
No.
No. If we have two points that are up vertical of each other, then we have a non-function. That was 6, and now 13, the manatee question. When my first child was in the womb, we looked at pictures of what developing fetuses look like. They look a lot like manatees, so we called her. We didn't know what she was going to be because we didn't find out, because we're like that. And so we just called her manatee for a long time. Or it. So a manatee eats 12% of its body weight each day. Okay. So let's just run an experiment here. If I told you that this manatee ate 1,000, or that this manatee weighs 1,000 pounds, and it eats 12% of its body weight in a day, how do you calculate how much it ate that day?
Y equals 0.12
times x, where x represents
how much the manatee weighs.
How much the manatee weighs, and y represents
how much it eats.
Thank you, shout out to Charlie. So we jump right to it. That is our function. And it is a function because if a manatee weighs a certain amount, it's only going to eat one amount of food, right? Assuming that all manatees are very well disciplined and think similarly to each other. They eat 12% of their body weight. Anytime you divide 12%, multiply by 0.12. Turn equation, identify the independent variable and the dependent variable. So x represents the weight. Y represents the food. They're both weights, weight of manatee, weight of the food. Okay, which is the independent? What's the dependent? Johnny?
Independent is the weight.
Independent is the weight of which, the food of the manatee?
Manatee.
Of the manatee, just to be clear. Weight of manatee. Okay, and this would be the independent, okay? So what maybe is another name for the independent variable? X, and X a lot of times is?
Input.
Okay, but I'll just chime in. Stepping over the cadence, but that's good. We got independent variable, X, input, okay? Pretty much synonymous with each other. Which makes Y the what variable?
Independent
variable, the output, Y. Okay, so there we are. B. Anyway, just a quick little thing here. How much is this manatee going to eat? It depends on how much the manatee weighs. So if one thing depends on another, if you could say that in a sentence, then you know you've got the dependent variable. How much is this going to be? It depends on this other thing. Dependent variable. B. Input-output table equation. Yeah, well, let's save ourselves some time. We have that input-output. So there's the input output table. Any questions about how that table gets made? Okay, then how about an answer on how that table gets made? How we make that table, Charlie?
We plug in the input for x and then
5.12
times x.
Mm-hmm. There's your y. Let's give it a quick test just on this first one, see if Charlie's right. Y equals 0.12 times 150. The calculator, 0.12 times 150. 18. Okay, so that manatee ate 18 pounds of food that day. And part C, I think that's everything. Part C, find the domain of the range. Find the domain of the range of the function represented by the table. What's the domain of this function? Alex?
X.
Oh, so all of the X's,
all
right?
All the X's, yeah.
So what, can you list off the domain for me?
150, 300, 450, 600, 750, 900.
Exactly, that's the domain. All right, and the range is, well, all the y values, right? that. Alex made a good example of the domain, so actually the range would just be that list of numbers. Like Alex made this for the open. So there it is. Part D. Interesting. Part D. The weights of three vanities are 300 pounds, 700 pounds, and 1,050 pounds. What is the total amount of food that these manatees eat a day? Okay, so the 12% is a daily amount of food. So in one day, how do we figure out, for instance, a 300 pound manatee, how do we figure out how much that manatee eats? Try it. In fact, it's been done, right? It's on the table. So how much will that manatee eat that day?
36 pounds.
36 pounds. How much will the 750 pound manatee eat?
90.
How much will the 1,050 pound manatee eat?
108.
Did the math already?
No.
No?
No.
1,000. You say 1,000?
I'm sorry.
You say 1,050 eats 180?
108.
Oh, well, this is a 900 pound manatee here. What I said was 1,050. So it's not on the table yet.
Oh, okay.
Right? It's not on the table. Okay, so 1,050. 1,050 times 0.12, 126. 126. So the question is, what will the total amount of food be that these three manatees eat? How do we find that? Add it all together. Okay, so whatever that sum is, that's the total amount for that day. How do we figure out how much they'll eat in a week? Johnny?
I will find 0.12 times 7.
Okay, so we can do this all again, make a new function, multiply this by 7. So our new function could be, let's give it another color, y equals 7 times 0.12x. Now we have a new function, a function that doesn't calculate how much they eat in a day, but how much they eat in a week, right? And then find all three amounts, add them together. Anybody see an alternative way?
Yeah.
Sean?
Just multiplying the bottom three by 7.
So we got this sum. We can multiply that sum by 7 because that's in a day, right? All three of them in a week. That'd be 7 times as much. Right? Kind of depends. It really depends maybe on, am I interested in finding, you know, more information? Am I interested in calculating the amount of food that more manatees eat in a week? Well, then I probably want a new function altogether. If I just want to know it this one time, then I'll just go ahead and add up that sum, multiply by 7. Kind of depends on what we feel like doing or what we are going to need here in the future. If we do want it just once, we can multiply that by 7. If you go that route, that absolutely would be the same thing. Okay. One quick thing, let me just make sure. Okay, so when it says write an equation in function form, that was part of number 3, what does that mean? Yeah, get it to be y equals so that it looks like a output, and then on the other side you got your input, all the stuff working together to make the output, and the output's just fed out through the other side of the equation, y equals. Okay, good. So you know what comes next. Play a piece of paper. You can write the equation in function form. You see why I asked that question before we started. Charlie told us we put it as y equals. So to get that, we could step by step subtract 4x. From both sides, divide by 2, y equals negative 2x plus 3. So it's in function form now. Got your input on this side with all the, I like to think of a function like a factory. It's got an indoor, it's got all the working parts and gears and belts and things on this side, and this equals to y is kind of like the outdoor, right? The finished product comes out at y. So, if we were to plug this negative 2 in there, can we do this in our heads?
Yeah.
All right, negative 2 times negative 2 is 4, plus 3 is 7. All right, negative 1 times 2 is 2, plus 3 is 5. And if we know something about linear functions written in slope-intercept form, right, the pattern will be as x goes up 1, y will go down 2, right? You can follow that, go down to 3, go down to 1. Okay. No, I'm not going up by one. I went all the way up to 5, didn't I? I didn't pay attention to that. Go up to 5, 5 times negative 2 is negative 10 plus 3 is negative 7.
Negative 10 plus 3 is negative 7.
Okay, so the domain is what?
7, 2,
2, 2, 5. So what is it? It's a list of numbers, right? It's negative.
-2, -1, 0, 5.
Sorry, each time somebody said it, it sounded like there was an extra one or not enough of one. Like I probably just didn't hear it right. And the range would be
7, 5, 3, 8, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7
So I want to teach you something about math and also about one of my pet peeves in grammar, okay, all at once. Here we go. So read those signs, which I think you can read. Does anybody see something, you know, a commonality between all three of these signs?
They all say less.
They all say less. Okay? And this is an example, three examples of pet peeve of mine and of the internet's, right? If you look at the internet, it will tell you how wrong these signs are. Does anybody know what's wrong with these signs? And the word less?
No.
And it's kind of, it's trying to convey a truth. It is, they do want you to use smaller amount of these things or have a smaller amount than 10 or, you know, use smaller amount of bags, smaller amount of napkins. Okay? Anybody? Okay. You're ready to learn something. You want to sound informed and educated? Okay? Don't say these things like this. And it very much has to do with what we're learning today about functions. The problem here is, take this guy for example, express it. This is like probably the most ubiquitous. Ubiquitous means just like everywhere, just all over the place, ubiquitous. It's every place that you look. You go into a Target or a Walmart or your local, you know, privately owned grocery store, there's going to be an express line. It's going to say something like 10 items or less, most often. When it should say 10 items, or 10 items or fewer. The word is fewer, not less. Okay? So what the difference between fewer and less is. This says, you know, I guess it's the clerk talking and says, what can I say? I was an English major. So it's a grammar thing. The word you should use in these cases is fewer. Okay? Not less. There are instances where you should use less, but it's not these. So now some people get it right. You can read here. Here is actually a store that their express line has 10 items or fewer, as it should. And this sign here said, try to use fewer bags. It says we should use fewer bags. This looks British because we don't call them carrier bags here usually. So probably that's from somewhere in. Or Europe somewhere. So, fewer is the word. Now here is the guiding principle behind whether I should use fewer or less. You can have less stuff, but if you have things, you have fewer things. Okay, does that make sense? You see this stuff? What do you notice about the difference between this stuff and these things?
There's
a specific amount, and then there's
like just
I don't
know, just like a bunch of.
Just like it could be a glob
of
that stuff.
Yeah.
So what are some things that there could be? There are things. Are there some examples in the last few slides that we looked at? What are some things that we can count off a specific number of? Okay,
how many items that you're buying?
Okay, items like 10 items or fewer, okay? So kind of general, let's try and get specific. Like what are some items? What are some things that can be counted as a specific number. Like there's either one of them or two of them or three of them or four of them.
Like blocks.
Okay, blocks. There's some blocks. So we would have more blocks or fewer blocks. What else?
Bags,
right? Example from the slides that we're looking at. Bags, grocery bags. Okay? You see what we're saying here? We can count these up. We can count them, like, on our fingers. One bag, two bags, three bags, four bags, five bags, and so on. Blocks. Gallons. If I count milk in gallons, then I can count a number of gallons, and I have more gallons or fewer gallons. Something thing about milk is, if you measure milk in gallons, well, then you'd say you have more gallons or fewer gallons. But if you just said milk, well, how am I measuring that milk? It's kind of up to me now, right? It's an uncountable thing. I can't count milk. Milk is this fluid thing. There could be, depending on how I measure it, now that it's not prepackaged in gallons, I could pour out a gallon and a half, a cup and three quarters. I could pour out 1 pound, 1.347 pounds of milk. See what I'm saying? I can have, if I had a cup of milk and 2 cups of milk, I can have any amount of milk in between there as well, right? Right?
Yeah.
How about your height? Like we can measure your height, right? In a stuff kind of way. If at one time you're 4 feet tall, 4 feet tall, and then later you're 5 feet tall, what could you say about you in between the 4 feet and the 5 feet? Sean?
You grew.
You grew?
More.
You grew, but did you shoot up from 4 feet to 5 feet immediately?
No.
So, in between there?
You were 4.5 feet.
4.5 feet. Were you ever 4.2 feet?
Mm-hmm.
Were you ever 4.23643944?
Yes.
I mean, I can get as small as you want, but there is, like, no height between 4 and 5 that I wasn't. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You had to be all those different heights to get from 4 to 5. Okay? 4.2, 4.75, 4.396492, 5.3 going on forever, 4.3 repeating. I would have to take on all those heights in between. Okay. Whereas things, okay, that I would say I have fewer of, I count them up one by one. With things that would be less, they can have any amount in between, like money. We don't just have $1, then $2. We can have $1.50, $1.25, $1.03. Right? There's all these values in between, and you can have any amount in between there. Okay? So, what we call this in math, we would use fewer if it were discrete. Okay? So this is what we're really getting at. So I'm using a grammar thing to teach you the words discrete and continuous. So discrete means I can count them up one by one. And actually, that's all I can do. 1 gallon, 2 gallons, 3 gallons, 4 gallons. Okay? But I don't go into the store and buy 4.3 gallons, usually. Right? I go in and I buy a whole number of gallons. Sometimes you can buy a half a gallon, maybe even a quarter gallon. Right? But for the purposes of this, I'll buy 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 gallons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 blocks. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 items. Right? Counting them up one by one. Continuous, how is continuous different from discrete? Can someone explain that? How is continuous different from discrete? How is stuff different from things? It doesn't just have to be 4, 5, 6, 7. It could be anything from 4 to 5, or between 4 and 7, down to the very decimal, right? Be measured in very small amounts, okay? Things like money. things like liquids, water and milk and so on. Things like height.
Weight.
Good. Other examples. Other examples of things that could be measured continuously.
Volume.
Volumes, right? You could have a pint and a half of something. You could have a pint and three quarters. You could have a 3.27 ounces cadence.
So if you, the sign that says less, you could come up to, like, buy something and then you could have half of your toy that you're buying or your candy, or is that kind of what?
You would have to, yeah, you'd have to be able to cut a toy into small pieces,
yeah,
right?
You could come up with half a toy.
You could, but we wouldn't. We wouldn't. We could. And if we wanted to make it to be less, I would have to be able to buy fractions of things.
Yeah.
Tiny little pieces. As small a sliver of the pieces I ever would want to do. But I wouldn't do that.
But then fewer,
yeah,
is just one whole or one or more,
mm-hmm,
whole objects.
Yeah, one, two things, three things. Tickets. I can only buy one ticket. I'm not going to buy 1.5 tickets, right? Doesn't even make any sense. I'm not going to buy half a ticket because half a person is not going to go to some concert or whatever. Whole numbers of items, or at least they take on a specific value, they have a specific interval in between, okay? Let's see. Yeah, and things can, we can change the way that we measure things to go from fewer to less, or from discrete to continuous, like gallons and just milk. Or wheels of cheese and pounds of cheese, right? If I measure cheese in wheels, okay, then, well, I have to buy one wheel or two wheels or three wheels or four wheels, right? Or slices, if you like. But if I measure it in pounds, well, I could conceivably buy any measurement of pounds that I want. Anything in between 1 and 2 pounds, anything between 2 and 3 pounds, it's continuous. It's fluid. Anything in between goes. Kids? Okay. You feel like you're getting an idea for what's discrete? Okay? That would be things you can count. And continuous, you see the guy who drew this picture just drew this globby thing because there's not like there's one or two or three of them. You could take half of this of the stuff, you could take a quarter of the stuff, you could take 0.23946 of the stuff. Any little piece or fraction of the stuff works, like weight or height or gallon or just liquid volume, things like that. Time. Another one. You do money. Got money, right? I'm using an example. And things that are just like, it doesn't really make sense to count, like love. Okay? I wouldn't have fewer love. Would have less love. Okay, see what I'm saying? Okay. So if we want to talk about what's discrete or continuous, cars. Here's another way to think of it. Discrete is something that you count, 1, 2, 3, 4. Continuous is something that you measure, right? You have to get on a scale or something like that to measure these things. You have to measure the weight, you have to measure the height, right? And you have to figure out exactly where it is it in between, like 4 or 5 feet. It's somewhere in there. Could be anything in between, okay? About trees. Trees, discrete or continuous?
Continuous?
Well,
depends on if you're talking about the height or.
Just the number of trees, like the number of trees in those.
Oh, number of trees is discrete.
Yeah, it's discrete, right? Even though a tree might be smaller than another tree, still a tree, just like a person smaller than another person. They're not half a person. By the way, people, discrete or continuous?
Discrete.
Discrete. discrete or continuous?
Continuous.
Continuous. We can have any area. Any area is continuous, even fractions of area. Okay? So, that's your task. Let's see if these few minutes left we can get started. So get at your books real quick. Nothing better than practicing for discrete.